Today we're going to be talking about dreams, visions, and I'm going to give my testimony. So I am going to be the only person on the show today without a guest, and that'll give me a chance to share my testimony with you and what my testimony has to do with Seder, that we use that term, having a Seder supper. Another way in the New Testament, it was called the Last Supper. And then in the book of Exodus, in Exodus 12, God gave instruction on how to do this Seder supper. So we're going to be talking about that. And I guess I'll start with in Exodus 12. It says here, "And it shall be that when your children say to you, 'What do you mean by the service?'" which is part of Exodus 12 when they're talking about all the different things you do to put this supper together. "What do we do about this service?" "Then you shall say, 'It is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord, who passed over the house of the children of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our household.' So the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so, just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron." And so they did. So that's what they did in the Old Testament. But it says here throughout the scripture that it's supposed to be throughout generation through generation. And I was told, well, that was the Jews. And anyway, in the New Testament, we did something else, although Jesus kept the Passover. So it's been really confusing for me. So anyway, I had this dream back maybe roughly 10 years ago, and that's what I want to talk about. This is where this whole adventure for me began. And then after I go through that and share a few things, then I'm going to talk about how you can very simply have the Lord's Supper, or the Last Supper, like they did in the Old Testament, or in the New Testament, rather, and in the Old Testament. So something maybe not as complex, but if you're interested, you're just getting started, you want to see what it's all about, I want to show you just a very simple way that you can get started, let's just say. Because it's not as hard as what, we think it might be. You know, it seems really foreign to a lot of Christians, and actually it's very simple, and it's a remake of the memory that Moses said that we should do. And when I say we, that's what I want to explain. Why do I say we? So I had this dream roughly 10 years ago. And in the dream, it was my babysitters were there, which they had since died. And so I was actually really happy to see them. One of the babysitters, the husband was a Jew. And then the other babysitter, a redhead Gentile. And so they're getting furniture, you know, they're pulling it up from the basement up and from the attic down. And I'm there helping them. And so that was the dream, basically, is we were just moving furniture. But you ever have those dreams where it's like, wow, that dream, it really meant something, and it just keeps gnawing at you and gnawing at you? And I know a lot of you will say, well, I don't have that many dreams, but most everybody has a dream occasionally that just really affects them in some way. So anyway, that's how this dream was for me, just that simple dream. I knew that there was something about it. So a few weeks later, I was getting tired of just thinking, what does this mean? So I sat there and I prayed and I said, God, I'm not going to get up until you show me what it means. And so within about a half an hour or so, I don't know, it might have been a little longer than that, it came to me. It said here, the voice said, when you see the Jew and Gentile coming together as one, the church will be working how it's supposed to be working. Well, of course, that's foreign to me because, I grew up, when I was younger, maybe we looked a little more into the Old Testament, but now, in this New Age kind of way of thinking, it's almost a New Testament-only belief system. And even though the Old Testament is filled with prophecies that are still supposed to come to pass, like in Daniel, in the last days, and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, they all talk about the times not just in the past or in those days, but also in the future. Out of the book of Revelation, those type of things. So I knew there was something to it. So what I did was I really started doing some research on this thing. And I'm not going to go through the whole thing, all the research, except that just to say that Exodus 12 is where this comes out of, the Last Supper for that Jesus was obviously part of, where he fulfilled the prophecy of the Messiah and being the perfect Passover lamb. That's Matthew 26, chapter 26 through chapter 28. And there's a lot of other chapters in the Bible too you can read about that. So I did some research, and I researched our church history, and I learned about Constantine and how Constantine was a Roman emperor, that he wasn't a Christian whatsoever. He followed like basically a Greek Roman theology at the time, and then so when he became a Christian, he went to he supposedly became a Christian, but he had the Christians do some of their paganisms, and then some of the pagans, he said, well, this is when Jesus was resurrected, and the whole thing got really confusing. But consequently, after all these years, you know, we just like Jesus said, we forsake the commandments of God for the traditions of men. Now, I don't want to get into Paul absolutely everything Paul said was right. There's no contradiction. Paul also did the Passover, by the way. Jesus did the Passover. So if you want to hear more about those details, feel free to go to my website, and it's under the section Ark of Safety, and I really spend a lot of time going through verses and what Paul was saying. And but to get out of that right now, because I just want to keep this very simple and very basic. Anyway, so I learned a lot of things. And if you look at the poster board that I have there, that has to do with the Passover, and it's called the Song of Moses is what I call the poster. But it's when the Israelites crossed the Red Sea, and then the Egyptians came after them, and then the Egyptians fell into the water. You know the story. And anyway, they still have all the artifacts there today. And even though, you know, coral has this property where the coral touches onto the metal objects of like a wheel or whatever in those days. And you'll see from the poster board that even though maybe the metal part of it is gone, that the coral took the shape of all of these wheels, and there's bone evidence. And then you go in the desert, and then they have the rock. Oh my goodness, the rock that Moses struck, that water came out, and so everybody was able to drink. I mean, this stuff is absolutely amazing. So anyway, I did all kinds of research, and what I did find out is we do have a lot of traditions. And so I want to get to a vision that I had. This was a real vision. It was the very first Seder. And I want to back up. The reason why I really like the feasts, and even the Sabbath day, you know, it is on Saturday. These are God's appointed times. It says in the Bible that they're his appointed times. So even though we don't have to do any of this for salvation, what we need is the blood of Christ for salvation. And, you know, he rose again, and he gave us salvation when we accept his sacrifice. And but part of the blessing of what he did is when we follow him, we get the blessings from following him. And if we don't follow him, like we do other things, some traditions rather than the Passover and some of the things that he did even back in those days, anyway, we just miss out, because those appointed times we're not able to get the blessing from. So here's a blessing that I had over my very first Passover that I took part of. This is what I'm talking about, the blessings that of this vision. So we were at somebody's house. It was not just their house, but it was an area that they rented by their house. And we did the Passover dinner, Seder dinner. It was great. And anyway, we were walking out to go, and I had my husband, my kids, and I had a friend with me. Well, I couldn't figure it out, but there was literally these ashes, such as you would see it from a burning bush, like a very major burning bush, these ashes that were coming out of this bush and landing on people, and nobody was doing this. And I was really confused. First thing is, what is this, these ashes coming out of the bush? And of course, that's weird enough as it itself, but then nobody seemingly was seeing this. And it was very clear. It wasn't like I was thinking I was seeing something. I know that I was seeing it. And I'm really glad that I had my friend with me because she saw it too. And we didn't even talk about it till afterwards. But I'm just looking at this. You know, people are coming out of this building, getting into their cars, and ashes landing on them, and they're not doing anything. And so, anyway, it took some time till I figured out, well, what does this really mean? And what I discovered that it meant, that I believe it meant, is that that was like a burning bush. And so just like, if you read in Exodus, when God gave Moses the burning bush and showed it to him, he said, take my people out of Egypt, and so they can be redeemed. And what I felt is I felt that that was a message, you know, teach people about, you know, my feast, my appointed days. That's what I got out of that. And also in that dream, when I was working with the Jew and the Gentile, what I got out of that was that I was going to be being part of that, helping people understand also God's appointed time, you know, that mixture. In the New Testament, a lot of people call it one new man. It's that the Gentiles are grafted into the Jews, what their the covenant of the Jews, and Jesus is a Jew, you know, came from the tribe of Judah. So we're grafted into that covenant. That the roots are already rooted in the things that happened in the Old Testament. So again, not for religious sake or anything, but for really, there's a deep blessing in that. And as I'm sharing these appointed times, when I have taken part of that, there's been blessing after blessing after blessing. So these are my dreams, you know, visions, testimony, and this is what I want to share with you on my experience. Now, what I want to go through is simply, if you want to have a Seder at your house in your church, here's how it goes sometimes. From what I've seen, usually when somebody decides they want to do that, they might be married and the other person aren't really that interested, and so sometimes it gets to be kind of a wrestling match that you don't want to get into. You know, people call you legalism. It's all kinds of things. Anytime you try to, if God gives you something to do, some people out there who are very, you really try to pursue what God wants you to do, you know the story. You get a lot of pushback. So this is the story with a Seder. When you try to do something like that, usually you get pushback. So that's what happened to me. So here's what you can simply do. Just prepare a nice meal at home and have a dish like this. And then you don't have to say a whole lot about it. But if people ask, then you can bring up the conversation. And the conversation is really what happened in the Exodus. So this is what a Seder plate is. It's just a memory. So I'm going to read just rather quickly. This is parsley. And by the way, you don't have to have parsley. You can have lettuce leaves or whatever. This is just a typical Seder plate. If you look it up, this is usually what they're going to show you. But again, it's the story behind it that it is what makes it, not the each little thing. So you can customize it, do it how you want. Anyway, so this represents life and growth. And so this happens around springtime when things begin to grow. So this is the time period. And it's that God really, his ultimate goal for us is that we have life and life more abundantly. So that's what this represents. And I'm really going to summarize, if there's people out here who've done this before, it can be very, very deep. Some of these Seders can go for all day. I mean, people actually, in some cultures, and when they do this, they actually really enjoy it. They love it. They'll do plays and skits and everything and sit there and recline and just have a good time. Sometimes they drink too much wine. And that's part of it, actually. So first we have the parsley. Okay, the next, the communion, of course, the bread and the wine. So the wine represents the blood of Jesus, but in the Exodus too, the blood of the lamb that they were supposed to put over their doorposts. But I'll give you more of a New Testament spin. It's really interesting because the matzah bread is what they use even in Jewish cultures right now. So it's interesting because it's bruised and it's striped. just like Jesus was bruised and he was striped for our iniquities. And, he was pierced for transgressions. So that's out of Isaiah 53. So there's a lot of symbolism behind the matzah bread, and it's also unleavened. That's another thing you might want to look into is unleavened bread 7 days before the Seder plate. So, and that's important too when you're doing this, to if you're going to go along with the story and what God tells you to do in Exodus, you don't have leaven in it, which is yeast. You know, there's more to it than that, but yeast is like you don't have rolls or you don't have regular crackers, you have unleavened crackers. Okay, so next, the bitter herbs is the bondage. The bondage is bitter, so they have these roots, and a lot of times they use horseradish to show those, and you know, people go and taste it, and the idea is, and you go, ooh, and your eyes will get tearful, and because the bitterness of the bondage that they experienced in Egypt, you know, caused many tears. That's the idea. Okay, and then the next then also is salt water. So this represents the tears. When you're in bondage, the tears. And, okay, then let's go to the plagues now. This, of course, isn't on the plate, but the part of the plagues is what happened in Egypt in the Exodus will again happen in the book of Revelations in the very last days. And so what happens is there's a separation where people who are caught up in the world system, you know, even Christians, even if they're Christian, like worldly Christians, lukewarm Christians, they'll be caught up into that too. And so the idea is to separate yourself. So what happened in the past will repeat in the future. So it's very interesting. This is why recounting this is why God wants us to recount it over and over and over again for a memory, so we don't repeat the same failures in the future. So the plagues of the blood, frogs, lice, flies, cattle disease, boils, hail, locusts, darkness, the death of the firstborn. A lot of these all happen in Egypt. A lot of these, if not all of them, will happen in the book of Revelation in the future as well. So if you ever want to take the time to read that, it's interesting, the parallels and the similarities. Okay, I have a chicken bone here. And it's normally what you do is you put a lamb's bone there. So I didn't have one now, so you can replace it, symbolic of the lamb. So it's interesting, in the book of Exodus, God had him use a lamb, and he gave instructions for that. Again, it's in Exodus 12. And then Jesus was the perfect Passover lamb. There's a whole interesting parallel all around that is very deep and interesting to look into. But also, what's interesting to know, that most people don't know this, they think that, you know, in the millennium, that we don't do any of this because, of course, Jesus fulfilled it, which, of course, he did. But in Ezekiel, and I can't remember, it's Ezekiel 40, 42, 45, something like that, right around there, you'll read that in the future we're going to be doing a future Passover. So if we're supposed to do it then as a memorial to the past. So in the 1,000-year reign, we can expect that. So I know, again, that's not being taught, but if you want to take the time to look into that, you'll find it really interesting. And it'll make you wonder, boy, why didn't I know this? Why haven't I been taught this? And, of course, that's what I have wondered too. But that's why God gives us dreams. That's why he gives us visions. You know, he'll speak to us maybe through this show, but maybe he's been speaking to you. Maybe, you know, there's things that each individual, he'll reach out in his own way. Maybe not to really do a Seder. Maybe it's something else. But pay attention to when God speaks to you, pay attention to what he's trying to teach you, because he knows where you're at. like nobody else does. And so he knows what you need to grow and to be happy and to prosper. Okay, and then the next thing that you see on the plate, last but not least, is the apple. And it's mixed, I can't remember the name of it, but it's a blend. It's mixed with apples, nuts, and honey. And what it represents is the joy out of bondage. And again, if we don't learn from our past mistakes, we will, you know, be part of the bondage. And I think, you know, we can say in a lot of ways, you know, our system, we already are, you know, politically speaking, you know, as our country has gone towards sin, you know, we our taxes tend to get raised more. We tend to have to work harder, less time home, less time freedom. You know, this things don't have to be that hard. And it's really, you know, a consequence of turning away from God's directives. So anyway, this is a very simple way to have a simple Seder. Just have your lamb, your leg of lamb, or if you don't like to cook that, you know, chicken, whatever. You know, just around the table, make a nice dinner, candlelight dinner. And just have the stuff out. And what you'll find is people will just come, and your family will come and eat, or your friends, and invite your friends over. And they'll eat, and they'll start saying, well, what is this? And then you can start teaching them. And now all of a sudden, you're fulfilling Exodus 12. You're sharing with people what we're supposed to be talking about, you know, yearly, so we don't fall into that bondage. Anyway, I thank you very much for listening to my testimony. And I know you all have yours. And, you know, keep those in mind. I'm sharing mine this time. But when God gives you things, when God wants you to share things, you know, do that. Share with somebody. God gives us testimony for a reason. All through Scripture, God tells people when they have a testimony, go tell what you have seen. You know, remember Jesus has said that. When somebody got healed, go tell what just happened to you. So I want to encourage you to do that. And I want to encourage you to have a happy Passover. Thank you for tuning in. Have a good week. Bye-bye.